Hey everybody, happy Friday and welcome to Collider Movie Talk, movie talk for movie fans. I'm your host, Sinead DeVries, and this is the daily show where we bring you the latest news from the world of movies, plus some insight into what it all means. Joining us this morning is Dennis Sen.
Welcome everyone to a brand new episode of Collider Movie Talk. Thanks for joining us here on a Friday. I also want to thank our friends at Screen Junkies, where we went and visited yesterday for a movie fight. A little exhausted from that.
Also here is Perri Nemiroff.
I'm absolutely fried from that. I walked out and it was just like all the adrenaline and energy just went out of me and I was probably fast asleep by like 9 o'clock last night.
And John Rocha.
Hey everyone. Yeah, I'm fried too from calling in for those 30 seconds that I called in at the end of the fight. I don't know, Dave, were you, I didn't get to go. Did you get to go?
I was not invited,
really,
no.
You were not invited to
They put me in the TV. I go to the TV fight sometimes.
With Roxy.
With Roxy, yeah.
But this, hello, everyone. I'm excited. We got a lot of stuff to talk about.
And also here is David Griffin.
Hello, I'm here too. I saw Ghost in the Shell last night in IMAX. Very good. I enjoyed it, actually.
What?
I did enjoy it. Okay. I did, yeah. Mm-hmm.
All right. Well, maybe we can talk about that a little bit later. All right. We have actually two news items that came up right before the show started. The first one up is a new Mummy poster dropped from Universal. We can bring that up. Check this out. What do we all think? Perri, what do you think about this poster?
I like it. It's striking. I look at something like that, and it's one of those types of posters that I could picture hanging, you know, extra large from the rafters in a ceiling of a movie theater. It is eye-catching, no pun intended, a little bit. But yeah, no, it's pretty good. I'm looking forward to seeing more and more of this movie just because I'm really looking forward to this cinematic universe. There's a lot riding on The Mummy in particular, and I mean, really, it could go one way or the other, and Universal's got a lot. They have a lot of pressure on this movie right now.
Rocha.
Yeah, I like it. I think you get the mini pupils, and you've got the writing on her face, which I you know, because we just got this, I don't know what the writing indicates, but the vibe is definitely a horror vibe, you know, like it's definitely conveying that which you want to see from this reboot of this franchise. Because obviously the Mummy ones that they did with Brendan Fraser, they were fun adventure romp type movies. This is going to be completely different. It seems like even from the trailer where you see Tom Cruise flying around in that plane, that's such an awesome sequence. But it lets you know this is the level that we're playing at, and this poster does this as well. It only shows you half the face, which again is a great conveys a great feeling of like there's another part of this that we're not getting, and it's mysterious. So it's great.
David?
I like that the attention's not focused on Tom Cruise for this one. Because obviously he's you know, one of the biggest superstars in the world. Also, too, I'm excited about the expanded universe as well because I really like Dracula Untold. I thought it was fun. I thought Luke Evans was great in that role. So I want to see all these monsters get together and, you know, have that big collaborative film whenever we get that monster universe movie. That'd be awesome. Yeah.
Perri, I want to ask you about this. I like the poster as well. Are you concerned at all that this new kind of expanded universe for this monster universe is going to trend a little too much towards action versus horror because of what we've seen from the trailers already?
I mean, it's definitely going to be action heavy, especially when you have a guy like Tom Cruise at the center of it, when we know the types of stunts he likes to do. But at this point, I'm almost glad that the horror isn't coming through in any of the promotional materials besides an image like this, because that would probably be an example of trailers taking it too far, because I imagine the movie's only going to intensify as her powers do. So I don't want to see any of that just yet. But going forward, that is probably one concern, is I do hope that the studio and all the filmmakers involved do embrace the horror, but I definitely get the impression that this is going to be an action-adventure horror cinematic universe.
It seems interesting, too, doesn't it? Because it's not saying... It's because some of these are being conveyed as heroes and some of these are being conveyed as villains. Are they going to come together and all be on the same side? You know, these are things that I think are in play at this point, which makes it exciting in a new way to kind of look at these old characters to see who's going to be on what side, or if they're all going to come together against the common villain, because the Mummy could be a villain or could be someone they harness to help them overall, with the Invisible Man, with Dracula possibly, with the Wolfman, those kinds of creatures from the Black Lagoon. There's all kinds of things they can play with, or Jekyll and Hyde as well with Russell Crowe. So who's going to be the real villain in the movie? I think right now it seems like it's the Mummy, but it could be Russell Crowe's Jekyll and Hyde. We just don't know.
They're going to definitely need like a Nick Fury character, you know, to kind of tie everything. Can I do a quick spoiler from Dracula Untold. Is that too new, or is that bad if I spoil it?
I don't even remember what you could spoil.
Obviously, like, it's an expanded universe, so obviously Luke Evans, they don't want to die because he needs to be in the expanded universe. That's not a spoiler to say, but at the end, you do see him come into present day. He might be in London, present day London. So, I mean, I'm wondering if maybe he'll be that character, if they have a character like him, since he's creatures are immortal, basically. Like, if they have a character who can kind of, you know, tie all these people together.
Well, have they said that Dracula Untold is connected to this one?
No.
I don't think
their intention was, though. It had gone back and forth so many times, but I'm pretty sure the last thing we covered on Nightmares was that he was out.
Yeah. Oh, no, that's too bad.
Because I feel like we also that's got an bad. Interesting mailbag question recently that asked if Luke Evans, you know, if Beauty and the Beast is huge and Luke Evans winds up being one of the biggest parts of it, could that be a reason to put him back in the ring with someone like a Tom Cruise and Russell Crowe and all those guys. Which
I hope they do. I hope they don't leave him out of it. I thought he was
I'm a big Luke Evans fan, so I wouldn't mind.
Because he did a good job in Beauty and the Beast. Maybe that his stock is rising now, you know, off of something maybe before where it wasn't so much.
That's a great point, yeah.
All right. We also had some Lion King news. Sinead, what do we got?
According to a report from Variety, Beyoncé is the frontrunner to voice the role of Nala in Disney's upcoming live-action remake of The Lion King. Though she hasn't accepted the role just yet, she is reportedly director Jon Favreau's... sorry, my thing closed out. She is reportedly director Jon Favreau's first choice to play the part, first voiced by Moira Kelly, in the 1994 animated classic. If she signs on, she'll join already cast Donald Glover as Simba and James Earl Jones, who will return as the voice of Mufasa.
David, what do you think about this potential casting?
Beyonce is always a good thing. Mm. You know, I mean, I love Beyonce. I love Lemonade. That's a great album.
Yes.
You know, she comes out and, you know, shaking it. I mean, I can't complain about it. And she has a fantastic voice, too. Do we have confirmation if they're making this a musical or not? Do we know if that's confirmed?
It's going to be a musical. I can't imagine this not being
so,
a musical.
What's interesting with these films is you want somebody, Roka, you were kind of joking, like you want somebody to make sure it's a good actress.
Yes,
right,
well,
who can
of course.
Act. And that's a tough thing. Like when you're watching Beauty and the Beast, some fantastic actors, and I think Luke Evans killed it in both the acting and the singing part.
But you're really champion.
I think some of them, though, aren't the best singers in the world because they're not pro singers. Beyonce is a pro. She's an entertainer. That's just what she does for a living. So if she can, you know, get those acting chops together. You know, I know she has presence. She was in the Austin Powers, mm-hmm. you know, as a foxy Cleopatra. Yeah. I think she can do a good job in this, and she'll definitely have the voice. That's what's going to stick in your mind is when she sings those songs, she has such an incredible voice. I think she'll be perfect for this.
Rocha.
Yeah, I think this is an interesting cast. It's smart casting, mm-hmm. if nothing else. It's smart casting because people were immediately excited about this. You know, the Beehive was like all crazy about it, and so could it happen? A lot of people love and respect her and love and respect the work that she does. And so you bring the right amount of attention to this character, right? I don't know that this character necessarily stood out that powerfully in the Lion King animated film, so this makes her stand out even more powerfully, and they may write new songs for her, because like you said, if she's going to sing. I think she's good as Foxy Cleopatra. I thought she was good in the first hour and a half of Dreamgirls, and so she has the potential to be, and even more so voiceover acting-wise, because I think you're right, David, she has a great voice for this kind of stuff. So can she bring the right levels to this character? It depends on how they're going to write it, but I think she's a great choice for Disney to bring the right people to come watch it, you know, and get people excited about the project.
Perri.
I am not concerned in the least of her doing a good job.
Right.
She's going to crush it as a voice actress, I think. And I think, I mean, really to answer that question, even if the studio didn't come right out and say, we are definitely doing songs, you don't hire someone like Beyonce for this role and then take out the music. The only concern I have with this is we're talking about one of the biggest music icons out there right now. You put her in a movie like this, and I just don't want to be looking at a lion and thinking Beyonce the entire time, you know? I just don't want to hear her voice overpowering other things in the movie, whether it's her voice overshadowing other people, other voice performers, or just her voice taking me out of the movie. I imagine that won't happen, though, for some reason. I mean, it sounds silly, but just like, you know, kind of like closing my eyes and trying to imagine it, I don't think that's going to be a big issue, but holy crap, this movie's going to make a lot of money. Could you imagine if we get a Lion King movie with Beyonce, like, as one of the top billed actresses?
Right.
Wow, Mark Ellis' dream might come true.
And for people who love the original, James Earl Jones coming back. So there's a balance there that could work. Yeah,
I think it makes sense twofold. One, because she's a singer, and they're probably going to keep going with the music. And then two, she's a name. I mean, we've noticed this throughout a lot of animated films where they cast actors that have no names purely so that they can do the, like these press junkets, they can do the red carpets, they can do these tours, and then they can put their names on these posters to get people in, and she's obviously a natural fit for that. Sinead and Wendy, what do you guys think about this?
All about Beyonce as Nala, but as adult Nala, I'm assuming they're going to cast a younger actress for young Nala. But with Beyonce, the thing is that like I have never really been like, okay, let's cast a popular artist as a role, because I feel like it takes away from what the movie is about. It's just that their voice. But I like her so much, and I think she's going to blend in well with the cast. I don't think she's going to overshadow, because Nala is in the forefront in the movie. She's in the later scenes in The Lion King, so and she doesn't really, in the original, she didn't really have that many lines. And I think, you know, Beyonce is just going to, she's going to blend in, but she's going to command the scenes that she's in.
Sinead?
Yeah, I'm all right with it. I'm not like as obsessed with Beyonce as the rest of the world seems to be.
Oh, the beehive is coming after you.
Oh no,
it's over.
Oh no,
I'm not saying I do. I really love her.
Agency is happening.
R.I.P.
I really do love her. I love her music, but she's not like one of those people who is like my idol right now. But I do think it would be a good fit. I like her speaking voice. Like when I hear, when I've heard her do interviews, her speaking voice is extremely like soothing and it's very feminine. So I feel like just if I was, when I heard this news, I was trying to picture like if I could remember her voice in my head, and it's a very distinct voice, Perri. So I feel like there is a possibility you hear her and you're like Beyonce. But at the same time, even though it's super distinct, it's also really sweet sounding and really like loving. And she has kind of like a romantic thing to her voice. So I don't know. It could go both ways. I totally see where Perri's coming from. I totally see the other side where I'm like, if we're just basing this on who can sing, who's got a wonderful voice, and she gets her acting chops together, like David said, like this could be really good. I have no idea.
I think her voice is going to blend into the movie much more than... I remember Scarlett Johansson in Jungle Book.
Yeah.
Like that, I was like, oh, that's Scarlett Johansson, where I think this will, you know, I know it's Beyonce, but I think it'll fit right in.
It also could be a situation maybe where the familiarity of the voice might suit the role. For all I know, the way they write it or the way that they add new songs for that character, because I think you're right. I think they're going to beef up that role for Beyonce if she's cast in this movie. But I was thinking similarly with The Rock in Moana, a very familiar voice where I feel like The Rock's personality that we know kind of boosted the role a little, but at the same time, I wasn't sitting there the entire time distracted by the fact that it was The Rock. It kind of just enhanced Maui.
All right, let's get to our first topic. Sinead, what have we got?
20th Century Fox has debuted a new trailer for War for the Planet of the Apes. The third chapter of the critically acclaimed blockbuster franchise finds Andy Serkis' Caesar and his apes forced into a deadly conflict with an army of humans led by a ruthless colonel played by Woody Harrelson. After the apes suffer unimaginable losses, Caesar wrestles with his darker instincts and begins his own mythic quest to avenge his kind. The film also stars Steve Zahn, Terry Notary, and Karin Konoval. War for the Planet of the Apes opens nationwide on July 14th of this year. Dennis, what did you think about this new trailer for War for the Planet of the Apes?
I really like this trailer. You know, I love the franchise. This one feels more like, especially because it's Matt Reeves, but also just timeline-wise, more of a continuation from the second one, where when the first one to the second one, there was like that big jump of time, and then the characters are in much different places. I think this one might feel like, I don't know how long after it actually starts. Like some of the shots, there was like that shot of the soldier that had the helmet and had Monkey Killer on the back of it. You had Woody Harrelson in his general outfit talking about abandoning humanity so that it could save humanity. Those things were cool. One thing I didn't really care for is there's kind of like a spoiler in the trailer that reveals a big kind of like, you know, plot, not twist, but like maybe they felt it was necessary. They needed that in the trailer. I don't know. What do you think, Perri?
I think I know what you're talking about.
It's with the big ape, I guess.
Yeah. That's what I thought you were going for. I actually don't think that was as much of a spoiler. No. If anything, that just has me slightly concerned that they're repeating a beat from the last film. But at the same time, it's like I had one of the lines written here that I will find after I stop talking, probably. But It seems like the way that that character was presented in this trailer, it's kind of like a new version of what we already saw, mm-hmm. and it's a new version that's going to continue enhancing this message of, you know, just trying to like the abandoned humanity to save humanity. Mm-hmm. It's just like, what are you willing to sacrifice in this sphere to get to the next step? And I think that that is more in that character's story, based on what I'm seeing from this trailer at least, than what we got from the last film. Wow, I just danced around a whole lot of spoilers, I think. But I love this trailer overall. The only spoilery concern I had was where the final shots of the trailer. Mm-hmm. But then again, I don't know where that scene comes up in the actual movie. For all I know, it's a first act thing, which I hope it is. I just got the impression that that's kind of a big showdown at the end. I didn't necessarily want to see that. But then again, that last shot of Caesar is a really freaking powerful shot. Mm-hmm. I can understand why they would want to put it there. The trailer's just really well-structured, though. I kind of like in the beginning how it reminds you of Caesar's journey. Mm-hmm. They have the repetition of apes stronger together paired with the humans chanting, and it comes at the beginning and it comes at the end. Mm-hmm. Just like a really nice way to bookend it and also just highlight the fact that this isn't just some sort of mindless action type thing. It's something that has meaning, and both sides are going on these journeys, and they're wrestling with what they have to do to ensure their own survival. I can't wait for this.
David?
I really like how the trailer opens. You hear John Lithgow's voice, from the first
the
one with James Franco, which was great. I just love the visual, the look of it. I'm not like that a huge Planet of the Apes fan. Like, I get pumped when these come out, but I always go see it and I enjoy it. And plus, we have Reeves directing this, and I'm curious to see what he's going to do for this is the second time directing this franchise, because he's got the Batman coming up, I guess, in 2019 now. So it'll be curious to see.
What's Batman?
Who's Batman? Who's Batman? Right, yeah, what's a Batman? So he's directing the Batman. So that could be cool, too. Also, just the money this franchise has made and how it's improved. Mark here put in the notes talking about how it made $481 million for the first one. Dawn made $710 million, so it's rising. No pun intended there. It's getting stronger. So it'll be curious to see how this does the box office, too. But Woody Harrelson shaving his head, talking to his army. I mean, he's such a good villain. He's one of my favorite actors out there. I'm definitely excited to see this.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I absolutely love the trailer. I love the darkness of the trailer. Mm-hmm. We start with winter, which is very reminiscent of the opening of the Justice League trailer.
It's coming.
Right, this idea of winter, yet this idea of darkness, right? Mm-hmm. And I love that. There's no real shots of spring or summer in this, whereas in the first one, there was all like spring and the fall, and like you got this stuff, and then it gets darker. Each one of these films get darker and darker, and it's a great point you bring up about the box office, Dave, because there wasn't really that many big stars in the second one, right? It was Gary Oldman and Andy Serkis, right?
Yeah.
And
Jason Clark.
And Jason Clark. Yeah, but Jason Clark doesn't...
He's not a household name yet.
Yeah, nobody's been running
out. Gary Oldman's a household name, but he doesn't bring
exactly
in, he's super not like talented,
it's not the 90s
in,
and then I think that's what's great about this franchise, is it doesn't need that. It's that powerful enough. Circus's acting as Caesar is so powerful, and you see him from the beginning, he's older, there's an anger to his face that wasn't there before, you know, that leading people is difficult.
He looks tired too,
right? Exactly.
He doesn't want war.
No,
he's not
right.
Looking for war.
And you can see that in his face, and the opening shot of those four or the five like soldiers there, you're Caesar, you're the one. Oh, there's the marvel of it, right? And what this trailer is doing is essentially telling you that they're laying the groundwork for 1968's Planet of the Apes, for the original, right? The little girl is rumored to be Nova, which is the Linda Harrison character from Right, all that. And then you see the apes on the beach, on the horses. That's totally a reference to the original 1968 film. So all of that is great. And you get some logic to Woody's character, which I think is nice coming out of the trailer. You get that idea. And I think they address the ape thing, because in the first trailer, a lot of people online were saying, why is an ape on the side of the humans? What's that all about? And I think they address that in this trailer to say, like, yeah, this is going to be a plot point. You noticed it. We're glad you noticed it. We're paying service to it by referencing it more here. And if you do, to me, basically, as John Rogo, if you do a battle war film set in winter and you hit the right beats, I am going to pay my money to go see your film. And this film has been great. And the first two are fantastic, so this looks great. And the same writer is coming back from the second one, too. Mm-hmm. So it's a good situation.
I don't know why this shocks me at this point anymore, but I was absolutely mesmerized and just like stunned by how good the apes look.
Yeah.
And it's not like they've never not looked good. I guess just sitting there and I was watching it on my laptop full screen and just like really looking at all the detail.
Yeah.
It's astounding. And then I think about other movies where I've seen them try to do, you know, digital characters, like creating faces like that. And God, this franchise is just so above and beyond in so many different respects mm-hmm. with that technique. It's incredible.
And we should mention the Steve Zahn character is that kind of like shaved down ape that's talking about human intelligence. Mm-hmm. That is great, great stuff that's going to lay the groundwork. Because already with Caesar killing Koba in the second one, there's this idea of like he's violating the rules that he set out. So he's discovering how to be, and it could cause the fracture that leads to these kinds of things within the community of apes.
Little side note, you know what's interesting too is the way they speak. Steven Zahn's character speaks really well.
Yeah.
Like very, and, yes. and like, but Caesar, since he's the first, he can mm-hmm. speak, but he's still not as, you know, fluent as the other guys are. It's interesting, yeah.
That's a good point.
The one little character point that I wanted to bring up before too, that makes this one new character that we were just talking mm-hmm. about different, is the idea of not being able to be human. Because, I mean, that's just it's something specific to that character, but it also highlights the larger issue of it's just never going to work.
It's the whole subtext of social issues that's going on there, right? And just like the line that both of you pointed out, right? We have to abandon our humanity to save our humanity. It's real topical. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Real topical. Yeah.
Yeah. All right, what's next?
Deadpool 2 is finally coming together. However, the sequel has yet to find an actor to play Cable. Michael Shannon is the rumored frontrunner, with Stranger Things' David Harbour also reported to have screen tested for the role. But probably the most high-profile actor to be considered for the role was found in none other than Brad Pitt himself. Comicbook.com caught up with Deadpool 2 director David Leitch at CinemaCon, and the filmmaker shed some light on why Pitt won't be starring in his very first superhero movie. We had a great meeting with Brad. He was incredibly interested in the property. Things didn't work out schedule-wise. He's a fan, and we love him, and I think he would have made an amazing Cable. Perri, what do you think about Leach's comments about Brad Pitt?
I do. I agree. I think Brad Pitt would have made an amazing Cable, but at the same time, I'm kind of happy that it's panning out this way. One, because I was actually just starting to think about it because of the Beyonce story this morning. Mm. I don't want a situation where anybody's trying to fight Brad Pitt for the spotlight. I mean, he is a very talented actor who's been part of many great ensembles, so I'm sure he would have worked with them, but that's kind of, I guess, the one potential downside of casting Brad Pitt in a role like this. And also, schedule difficulties. The guy's a busy man, and this is one heck of a commitment. See Michael Shannon have this opportunity, but perhaps even more so at this point, I want Harbour to have it.
Mm.
He's incredible in Stranger Things. He does not get enough credit for the smaller roles he's had in previous movies. I really think this guy needs his time to shine beyond Stranger Things. So I'm hoping that he winds up snagging the role. But in terms of this quote, I mean, this is kind of how I thought it was going to pan out based on the last story we covered about Brad Pitt being in the mix to play this character. Because I think at the time we were saying something like, the report said something like he's not officially out. It depends on if World War Z2 goes. It's just like I had a feeling that it wasn't going to work out with his schedule. And this is kind of the best possible scenario because we have two great backups. And then also the fact that Brad Pitt was incredibly interested and giving this project the time of day at all has to mean that they've got a great script and a great character here. So I think this is perfectly fine.
Rocha.
Yeah, I love this idea. I think this, I wish it would have worked out, you know, but it makes... There's a lot going on in Brad Pitt's life. You go to IMDb, there's only three projects. So I don't think it's a scheduling situation necessarily that powerfully. I think it's more about, hey, he's going through a divorce. Like, there's reality. As much as we want to, you know, kind of put our stars into these movies and have them work, they're human beings. And there's other stuff going on in their lives. You know, this is a really big thing he's dealing with. It's a lot of children and the stuff with Jolie. There's PR wars going on. I mean, they've kind of settled it down now, but World War Z is on the horizon. He's possibly working on that. Is that going to happen? So there's probably a lot of stuff being, you know, taking up his time right now. And to play Cable, he's going to have to pound the weights and hit the gym. And, you know, and he's an older guy. He's almost, he's 50?
53.
Yeah, 53. Mm. That weight does not come on that quickly when you get older. You got to really hit it. Like Hugh Jackman, one of the main reasons he wants to step away from Wolverine is because of the difficult training schedule he has to put himself through as he gets older and older to play that character and look the way he does. And Pitt would have to put on weight to because Cable is a huge dude. So those are those things that you have to factor into these situations. It's not going to work because they're starting to shoot in a couple of months. No way he's going to put on all that weight in a couple of months. It's just not going to happen without HGH or something. So it's an unfortunate situation. He'd have been a great choice. Perri makes a great case for David Harbour. Absolutely. This might be his chance to get in there. I personally think Michael Shannon would be great because he just conveys that gravitas. But, I said it.
Wow. But, I thought you were doing it on purpose.
No, put a dollar in the jar.
Everyone take a shot.
Sorry. But I think Michael Shannon needs a shot to redeem him, to have some redemption in the superhero world off of Doomsday. He did a great job with it. I don't think it was the right situation. Or I loved him in Zod and Man of Steel, but people were uneven about that movie, and people were even more uneven about Batman vs. Superman. So I would like him to have a shot at something like this. And I think it would be a great challenge for him to play off Ryan Reynolds. I mean, that would just be so much fun. Someone as straight-laced as Shannon, but with a smirk on his face, against someone like who's so overtly playful and smartassery like Ryan Reynolds. It'd be fun to see those two battle. But David Harbour, you can't go wrong either way, I don't think.
Yeah, I think there's confirmation of some of the rumors we heard. Yeah. We talked about this last week about Brad Pitt possibly playing Cable, also Michael Shannon. It sounds like the director, David Leitch, is excited. And I think that's who he wants. He wants Michael Shannon. Brad Pitt, I also mentioned last week, I think he's a fantastic actor. I don't think he's a good fit for this role. And I think it is more of a... Beyond scheduling, it's commitment.
Yeah.
Like, if you sign on to be Cable, you're not being Cable for Deadpool 2.
Right.
You're like Deadpool 2, X-Force, maybe a Cable spinoff movie. It's just a long thing that maybe he doesn't want to do. David?
Yeah. I'm really happy that Brad Pitt is going to focus more on his producing, I think. If you look at his IMDb, yes, he only has a few projects in the acting categories, but in producing, he has a ton. Yep. And a lot of those, shameless plug for TV Talk, there's a lot of TV projects he's working on. He's doing a Lois and Clark miniseries right now. He's producing Feud on FX, which is fantastic. Oh, yeah. He did the OA on Netflix. I know a lot of you like the OA out there, crazy, weird show on Netflix. Oh, you didn't like it, Rocha?
It wasn't my jam.
So I'm happy to see he's doing that. And like Perri said, of course, saying it well, that hopefully these other actors will have a shot. You know, I mean, Brad Pitt can always come back and do whatever he wants because he's Brad Pitt. So these other actors, Harbour, maybe Michael Shannon will have a shot to do Cable too.
All right, let's move on to a buy or sell. Sinead, what do we got first?
According to a report from Jeff Snyder via the tracking board, Warner Brothers wants Get Out helmer Jordan Peele to take the reins on the new Akira adaptation. Warner Brothers has been trying to adapt the popular 1988 anime for a while now, passing through many directors in the process. The anime takes place in Neo-Tokyo and follows the leader of a biker gang, Kaneda, as he teams up with a resistance member, Kei, and others to fight his friend, Tetsuo, who is threatening to unleash his psychic powers on the city. Peele and Warner Brothers have yet to comment on the story. Rocha, would you buy or sell an Akira adaptation directed by Jordan Peele?
Tetsuo! Yeah, I would absolutely buy this, because Jordan Peele did such a great job with Get Out, and... on a $4.5 million budget to generate as much as he's generated, still generating, what's 150, just crossed 150 million or something this past weekend. So he is a commodity now, right? He can sell. He had talked about that he was going to jump on and do these horror films that were kind of breaking the convention of the racial stereotype. Like, he was going to tackle a lot of stuff. So I think since he's in this mindset, it still works for this. This idea, and then coming off the Ghost in the Shell controversy, however you feel about that, there was controversy. There's issue with this. Initially, and they've been trying to do this film for like 15, 20 years. They've been trying to do a lot of adaptation, constantly dancing around with different directors, different actresses, people like Keanu Reeves, people like Zac Efron.
The Hughes brothers were looking at it.
The Hughes brothers were rumored to be a part of it and too as well. So like, there's so many people that have had a shot at this. I think Jordan Peele has a real shot, but I think it all depends how Ghost in the Shell gets received. I really do.
Oh, yeah,
I think
for sure.
They're going to look at that and see what the box office is like and see. And it's not getting the greatest reviews. It's not getting terrible reviews, but it's not getting the greatest reviews, so we'll see what happens there. But what I personally loved, I buy this idea at all. I think I buy it so much. I think Jordan would bring the right attention to detail, the right knowledge of this of the source material, and... this idea, he already has this idea of respecting minorities, I don't think we'd get a white cast as these Asian characters. I think it would be a little more of respecting the source material and respecting the ethnicity of the characters in the original animated film directed by Katsura Otomo. I hope I'm saying that right, from 1980. It's one of my favorite animes, bar none. It's one I go back to all the time. I bought the 25th anniversary edition last year. It's so good. And so I think if you're going to pick the right director, this guy who's shown you he can really do some amazing work in small character moments, why not give him a shot at a bigger landscape or bigger thing to do more with it? We've seen this happen already with directors doing smaller films, doing bigger films. Colin Trevorrow's jumping into this mix now. We see this happening more and more. So I think Jordan would be a great choice to do this.
Yeah, I'm going to buy it as well. I actually still need to see Get Out. But I mean, before when we heard that he was going to direct a horror film, you're like, really?
Yeah.
The comedy guy. So now that there's all this positive buzz about him doing a genre that people aren't familiar with, then he's jumping over to something. This is totally different than a horror film. So I feel like they're looking at just his directing talents alone, and I buy that. And you're right, though. Ghost in the Shell is going to determine a lot. While I didn't care for the film, I feel like the reception from critics has been lukewarm. Yeah. It's been mixed to positive, and I think the audience seems to be, at least looking online, willing to embrace it. I don't know if it's going to do well at the box office, but yeah, they really, Akira's been in development hell for so long that they're waiting and seeing what happens with this film. Yeah. David?
I hope it gets made. I'd definitely buy it, and I'd buy Jordan Peele directing this if it does. I mean, Akira came out in 88, so I was only 4 years old when that came out. I think I saw it in the early 90s. Probably about 10 years old when I saw it, and it really changed my perspective, and I hope that the movie can capture this, because it made me more curious about Japanese culture, because when I first saw it, I didn't get what was going on. There's a lot of subtext and post-World War II atomic era, like, Japanese culture in there that I have no idea anything about, because I was growing up in Buffalo, New York. I had no idea what was going on. So it made me get into Japanese culture and learn more about Japan. So I hope if they do make this, get the casting right, that's fine. But also, too, just embrace the culture that it comes from, and hopefully not shy away from it and try to make it safe. I realize they have to bring in the numbers, but I hope they don't make it a safe film. I felt one thing with Ghost in the Shell, for me, I enjoyed it, but I felt it was a little safe. I think they could have even gone a little deeper with that. That's the one thing I didn't like about it.
Perri?
Yeah, I'm a little mixed on this, and I think I'm leaning towards selling it. At this point, surprise, I'm a huge Get Out fan, and I can't wait to see what Jordan Peele does next as a director. I don't care what it is. If it is Akira or if it's something else, I'm going to watch it. I'm just not 100% on board with the trend of one director having one big hit movie as their feature directorial debut and then snatching them up and making them adapt a property that's been in the works for however many years. It's going to be a big budget film. There's going to be a lot going on that he didn't already tackle in Get Out. I just really like the idea of letting directors just use their resume as a stepping stone to get there rather than throwing them in the deep end. And this is going to be a hot property for Warner Brothers. And it only makes sense for studio execs to be watching him like a hawk and to be giving him guidance. And I think Peele is someone who is going to be in much better shape if he has the time to make it his own thing and sit back and do it right. And this is going to be a very high pressure situation. I would almost hope that he would do one more movie with a somewhat higher of a budget level compared to Get Out, and then maybe jump into this. And I'd have a little more faith, but, you know, I'm a fan of Peele. I'm rooting for him no matter what he does. I don't necessarily think this is the right pairing, though.
All right, what's next?
According to Showbiz 411, Jeremy Renner won't be able to appear in the upcoming Mission Impossible 6 because of his commitments to Marvel with Infinity War, Avengers 4, and a rumored appearance in Ant-Man and the Wasp. Renner was set up as the heir apparent to the franchise with his role in Mission Impossible Ghost Protocol, but now it seems we'll have to wait and see if Renner and his character will return in future movies should Mission Impossible 6 break box office records. David, do you buy or sell the news of Jeremy Renner not appearing in Mission Impossible 6?
I guess I would sell it because I wish he was in there, but I'm trying to figure out.
Nailed it.
I'm like, how do you buy things?
With money. With money.
Yeah, how does this work? How does commerce work?
There's a lot of money in the gravitas jar right now.
Oh, the gravitas. Yeah, got to pull out of there.
I said it once.
Renner was kind of, he felt like he was going to take over the world a few years ago. I mean, he looked like he was going to take over the Mission Impossible franchise. Looked like he was going to take over the Bourne franchise. And then he's just got, I don't want to say he got relegated to a side character because, I mean, you know, Renner's eating. He's got a paycheck coming. Yeah. The boy's eating food. But he's not the movie star I think we thought he was going to be. And I know Hawkeye, maybe people are like, oh, he's probably the least important Avenger. But I like him. I like Renner. I think he has presence. Mm-hmm. He has a gravitas. That's an appropriate word to use for that.
Sure.
He does. And I'd like to see him do more. But I'm happy that he's doing more Marvel properties. I think he'd be perfect for a Netflix series. Do a Hawkeye Netflix series. I know he's a movie star, but I'd love to see him do a Netflix series. So I hope he comes back to Mission Impossible after he's done with his Marvel commitments.
Perri.
Yeah, I'm in the same situation. So I'm gonna sell the story because I've enjoyed Jeremy Renner in the Mission Impossible franchise. Then again, if someone had to come out of this scenario and someone had to be plucked out of this team, I think I would pick him above some of the other characters, because even though he has served the group well, I don't think he makes as much of an impression as, let's say, like a Simon Pegg.
Sure.
And at this point, after Rogue Nation, I would be so bummed if, like, Rebecca Ferguson wasn't in the movie. So, and he's got other great commitments, too. So at least he's doing other solid work. One thing that's worth pointing out that we were discussing a little earlier in our pre-pro meeting is a lot of people are taking the attention away from the Mission Impossible story, and they're focusing on how the source article said that he can't do this because he's shooting two Avengers movies, and they're naming the Avengers Infinity War and Ant-Man and the Wasp, whereas the Collider.com article suggests that perhaps the source article was just confusing the fact that the two Avengers movies are shooting back-to-back, and it's not necessarily just Avengers, and then, oh, because like it's also coming out in 2018, Ant-Man and the Wasp. So I would just recommend not getting too carried away with that story if you see it circling right now.
Yeah, I actually buy that he's not in the franchise. I think Jeremy Renner is a terrific actor. I just feel like, yeah, like David mentioned before, he was supposed to take over the Mission Impossible franchise in Ghost Protocol. That didn't happen. He came back for the next one. It was nice seeing him there, but he is in a central role in this group dynamic. He also was supposed to take over for Matt Damon for the Bourne franchise. So, yeah, I feel kind of bad for him, but at the same time, I agree with David. Like, it's not like he's starving. So, it's fine that he's on this.
Yeah.
Rocha?
Yeah, it's a shame to see him go. I liked him in Ghost Protocol because I think he gave as good as he got from Cruise. But in Rogue Nation, they kind of relegated him to kind of the more boring stuff, which I thought was kind of disservice to the character. Because I like William Brandt as a character. I think I thought he was going to be a great great foil for Tom Cruise's character to go back and forth through the movies. But unfortunately, you know, we had Rebecca Ferguson come in. Not unfortunately in a negative way. I mean, like, it's just the way it worked out. Rebecca's a great, great character, and I'm glad they're keeping her for this next installment. I think she's a great addition to the series. And then you've got Henry Cavill coming on. And Baldwin coming back, so there's already a lot in the movie and with actors and presence, and so you got to cater to that. And I think Renner being squeezed out, it's not a negative thing in terms of like he's like you said, David, my man's eating food, he's fine, he's making money. First world actor problems. I got to back out of this franchise to be in this other franchise. You're fine, he's fine. But I think we're gonna miss something from him being in there because there's something about him looking at stuff going, you got to be kidding me. He is the audience.
He's an everyman.
Yeah, he became the audience for us in those two films. Yeah. Like he was like, oh, that's weird. I don't know what that means. So he did that for Tom Cruise's Ethan Hunt. But I sell it because it's a shame to lose him. But it makes sense and it's okay. The film is going to be great either way, I think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. All right, what's next?
Netflix has released a new trailer for War Machine, the highly anticipated first Netflix feature to star Brad Pitt. The dark and satirical story directed by Animal Kingdom's David Michaud is based on the book The Operators, the wild and terrifying inside story of America's war in Afghanistan, and stars Pitt as decorated U.S. General, General Glenn, whose ultra confidence was cut down by a journalist's expose. The film also stars Tilda Swinton, Sir Ben Kingsley, Anthony Michael Hall, Topher Grace, Will Poulter, Scoot McNairy, and Meg Tilly. And it is available on Netflix starting on May 26th. Dennis, do you buy or sell the new trailer for War Machine?
I'm going to buy the trailer. I liked it, but it didn't blow me away. I'm not like seeing this going, oh man, I can't wait till this drops on Netflix so I can check it out. But I like the director. He did Animal Kingdom. He also did Rover with Guy Pearce and what's the
Robert
Twilight? Twilight Boy.
Yeah.
I actually like this more for what it represents with Netflix. Netflix is changing the game. They're changing the game. They already changed the game with television. They're going to start changing the game with movies. You have now a Brad Pitt movie going to debut on Netflix, and then you're going to have a Martin Scorsese movie debut on Netflix. Now you're going to change the way the audience perceives how movies are released. Now it's more of a, do I think like this movie's going to be huge and tons of people are going to watch it? No, I don't think so. But I think just bringing that name to Netflix is worth it for them alone. There has been some kind of comparisons for the story to Generation Kill, which was on HBO. Yeah. Generation Kill is one of my favorite television miniseries of all time. So that's a high bar to set for it, but I am looking forward to it. Perri?
Yeah, I'm going to buy this. I liked it. To be completely honest, I had to watch it more than once to really get into it just because the way that they described it was part reality, part savage parody. So knowing about the true material that this is based on, it's a little hard to bridge the gap. I think it just takes some getting used to. But once you do get used to it and you see what they're trying to achieve by telling this story, it could be pretty bold and fun and actually meaningful too, which is really nice. But one of the biggest selling points for this one with me is just the packaging. I mean, David Michaud directing, Brad Pitt, Tilda Swinton, Ben Kingsley, Anthony Michael Hall, Topher Grace, Will Poulter, Keith Stanfield, Emery Cohen, John Magaro, RJ Kyler, Blue Ranger, hey, Alan Ruck, Scoot McNairy, oh my God. Like, I want to see this ensemble. I think that I am looking forward to it after seeing this trailer, but just with that group of people in mind, I'm dying to see it.
Rucka.
Yeah, I can't believe you left out Alan Ruck. I mean, Cameron from Ferris Bueller's
Day
Off.
Ruck.
Did you say Alan Ruck? Okay. You said so many. I'm sorry.
Yeah, he was like the second to last
Cameron.
One I, said.
I love Cameron in Ferris Bueller. Okay, no, this is great. As a guy who served 8 years in the military during the first Gulf War, you know, to see this going on, this Afghanistan, addressing this Afghanistan conflict this way. And I think this way is the right way to address it. Because having served, let me tell you something. I'm not going to break key fob here, I don't think. Mm-hmm. There can be a bunch of madness and lunacy when you're involved. And some of the orders you get, you're like, this makes absolutely no sense. And I think what you're seeing here in the trailer is you're getting an idea of what they were going for, what they were trying to do. I think that last line that guy says to Pitt is like, we don't want you to win it. We just want you to manage it. You know, something like that. That lets you into what this situation was like. This guy approached it from a whole different point of view, wanting to actually win the war, focus on winning the war, and changing that region where other forces were coming in saying, well, just do enough to, like, keep us in a foothold and whatever. So there's a lot going on here. There's shades of Apocalypse Now in terms of that overall vibe, in terms of the approach to it. There's shades of Catch-22, the Joseph Heller novel. There's shades of Generation Kill, absolutely. I think there's shades of Three Kings in this as well.
Yeah,
this idea of the seriousness with a little bit of the humor of the overall nuttiness of the situation. And initially, when you're watching the trailer, you're like, oh no, Brad Pitt's doing one of those voices. I don't know.
Inglourious Basterds.
Right, yeah. Inglourious Basterds, right, doing that kind of thing. And you're like, I don't know. And then you understand that it's part of this overall vibe. And I know, I've met people in military like this guy, you know, this, like, when he's clapping like this in the, you're just like, yep, I know that guy.
He kind of runs kind of stiff. He's running.
Yeah. I've met that guy. Yeah. I've trained under that guy. I know those guys in the military. So to me, it feels very authentic. And I think a lot of people will actually watch this, Dennis. I think the military contingent in this country is very powerful and very strong. And this seems to be addressing it in a way where they respect it and also address the lunacy of being involved in a situation like this. So I think it will get a lot of views.
Yeah, I buy that. I'm excited to see this. It's tough. I mean, if you're out there, not to get political, but I think it's just something on YouTube. It's just history. Check out Dwight D. Eisenhower's industrial war machine. You know, the industrial... industrial complex. Video, his speech. Yeah. I mean, talking about this whole thing about having a foothold there. Mm-hmm. We don't want to win the war because, you know, war drives all this financial stuff. Right. I mean, it's a crazy system, obviously, that affects, you know, millions of people that we don't see here in the United States, of course, because it's somewhere else. And I think this is addressing that. It is going to be tricky to balance the humor with the seriousness of this war. I mean, John, of course, you know better than I do, but I'm glad they're tackling this issue because it's an important issue to talk about. Yeah. I mean, it's really powerful.
Well, and Kingsley's Cars, I was just like, how did I not conceive to cast that?
Just like him.
Yeah. It's madness.
Yeah. Yeah. All right, what's next?
Disney and Pixar has released the short Dante's Lunch, a short tale, which introduces the dog from their upcoming new release for Coco. Dante will feature in the movie Coco, which stars the voices of Gael Garcia Bernal, Anthony Gonzalez, Benjamin Bratt, and Renee Victor, and centers on a family's generations-old ban on music, and Miguel, who dreams of becoming an accomplished musician like his idol, Ernesto de la Cruz. Desperate to prove his talent, Miguel finds himself in the stunning and colorful land of the dead following a mysterious chain of events. Coco will be released on November 22nd, 2017. Rocha, buy or sell the short Dante's Lunch.
I buy it so much. Like from the first, I cried during the trailer. Like
I thought you were gonna cry now.
Yeah, I'm telling you something like this. This is so important for my people to see something like this on screen. See something through Pixar. See our, you know, Latinos, Hispanics, whatever you want. Like seeing some of our stories up there. It matters. It matters. And to see that, to see the way it's done, you know, I thought Book of Life did a nice job with this, and I think this is going to a whole nother level with it. And just the scene of Miguel going in at the end of the trailer, and he sees the land that he has. Oh my! You know, he sees his dog who leads him in there. You're just like, oh man, this is going to be a powerful film. I'm probably going to cry all through it. But this short is so sweet and perfect, and lets you know that Pixar is putting their stamp on this story. You know, but still not losing. The vibe, the ethnicity of what they're addressing, which I think is so great. I think they did it in Moana as well. And I think they're just smart with how they're approaching this stuff and how it's moving. And the dog is so cute and funny and the bone, and it ends up, and then you get the twist that the bone that was getting the best of the dog, in the end, the dog is now biting the leg of the guy whose skeleton it was from. Mm-hmm. So it's just brilliant the way it's all played out. And they show you like the vibrant colors of what I imagine is a Mexican town that they're in, and all, you know, on the roof through the different vending stands. So to me, I buy this so much. I think they're doing the right approach to this. And as I said, for someone who's a Latino like me, this is so awesome to see. And I cannot wait to see the film, and everything about it seems like they're doing it in the right way. And it's going to be one of these ones that really knocks it out of the park again.
David?
Yeah, I'm pumped. I definitely buy this. It looks so good. I love how you can tell the town is setting up for the big festivities. Yes. I love the dog's name's Dante, because Dante kind of looks like leads him into the land of the dead, you know? And I love how you see how they're setting up all those flowers. And those flowers are used on the Day of the Dead. And the roads in the underworld, they're paved with those flowers, which is really cool, too. I just love all the authenticity, like Rocha was saying. I'm definitely seeing this.
Yeah, I'm going to buy this as well for two reasons. It was a cute short. And two, it's a great marketing tool. You take a side character from the main film, and then you introduce the audience to him this way in a little nice, cute short, and then they get invested in that character. Then they're going to go want to see the movie. So smart both ways. Perri?
Did you have to ask me? It's a little short about a cute dog. Of course I'm going to buy it for that reason, and many others also. But they've also just done a great job with short form filmmaking. I mean, I know this is part of a bigger story, but when I first read the headline that we got this, I kept thinking about Feast, which is another adorable short about a dog. Oh, yeah. But I love this, and I think it's an absolutely brilliant marketing tool. It's a smart approach to kind of baby-stepping people into this world. The last trailer did a great job of just creating that environment and that atmosphere in the world, and just making sure that you were looking at, like, you got to know the characters. You got to know the color palette that they're going to work with. And even in this, it's a good example. Even though I was hardcore tracking the dog, because I wanted the damn dog to get the bone so badly, at one point, I stopped to think, wow, this music is incredible.
Yes.
I'm going to love hearing this for an hour and a half to 2 hours. Mm-hmm. But it just seems this is a perfect example of showcasing how every single element of this production really could be exceptional. I'm so excited for Coco.
And it showcases the culture, right? They go through that family that's all around the huge table eating. Yeah. That's the culture there. He ends up in a luchador mask with a cape on when he's like, it's just, all of it's just so well done, man.
Wendy and Sinead, what did you guys think? Sinead?
I liked it. The trailer for this movie is so sweet, and you can, like Rocha said, you can tell it's going to be really, like, meaningful. Like, it's going to be one of those Pixar movies that you're like, oh, damn, like, we needed this. And I'm really excited about it. The short is so cute. Like, I just like how colorful everything is that I've seen so far. And everything looks, like, really well animated. So just a little tiny short like this, which is just supposed to, like, make us laugh and, you know, perhaps get our eyeballs on the project, actually does a lot more, because it's setting this world or creating this world that really looks like it's going to be really beautiful. So I'm super excited for this. Dog's super cute. I don't know. I really like it. I think it's awesome.
Wendy?
I liked it a lot. I mean, you put a cute dog in front of me and make it do cute things. I'm gonna love it. I'm gonna buy it. And it also gave me like a lot of Animaniacs vibes, like him going through the fence and stuff like that. It's really colorful. I'm really looking forward to the movie.
All right. What's
Five Nights at Freddy's creator Scott Cawthon recently tweeted an image showing a director's chair with the name Freddy written on it in front of a screen featuring the banner for Blumhouse Productions, teasing a possible adaptation moving forward at the specialty horror production house. Five Nights at Freddy's is the addicting game that sees a night security guard terrorized by animatronic robots at a Chuck E. Cheese-like restaurant called Freddy Fazbear's Pizza. No confirmation as of yet, but if the picture holds true, then Five Nights could be getting a fresh start at Blumhouse after being in development hell for quite some time. Perri, do you buy or sell a possible adaptation of Five Nights at Freddy's produced by Blumhouse Productions?
First off, bye. Second, I wish someone was recording our reaction when this picture first came up. I see you peeking over the computer, Riley. When this first came up, before we read anything, we just looked at Freddy on a director's chair in Blumhouse, and we're like, no way, like Freddy Krueger.
Yeah.
This is a fine consolation prize, though. When I heard about them adapting Five Nights at Freddy's, and also, obviously, I like horror, so many people have told me to play the game. I actually don't really like the game, and I have a very addictive personality, so I'm surprised that I didn't get super addicted to it. However, that does not mean it's not going to make a great movie. I mean, you're talking about like Chuck E. Cheese-like animatronic characters like being evil. That sounds brilliant. That sounds like so much fun. And I'm just so happy that this is getting new life at Blumhouse, no less, because I feel like Blumhouse is the kind of place that's going to treat it right. They do have a lot of fun with their horror movies. That, I mean, you know, there's ones that are sheer terror, but I feel like most of the ones that I know and love from that production company have that fun horror vibe that I tend to be drawn to. And just reading up on, I think his name is Scott Cawthon, whoever created the game.
Yes, Scott Cawthon.
He posted the picture, and he's also posted on some sort of website about his experience with the movie being in development hell and not getting out. And, you know, just reading through his post, it seems like his mind is in the right place. Like, he just really wants to do that material justice. And I don't know. I think if that mindset is what he has and he joins forces with a team like the team that's at Blumhouse, this could really wind up being one of the next great horror franchises.
I'm going to buy it as well, just because of Blumhouse's track record. They can take smaller movies and make them, you know, they make lots of money based on small budgets. This is a known property. They can take this and make this even larger. But I do remember when you were showing around that picture, I don't think it was a wise idea for them to release this as the announcement picture for people, because that is the first thing you think of when you see this. You think Nightmare on Elm Street. You look at Blumhouse, which does horror, and then you see Freddy. You're not thinking Five Nights at Freddy.
It wasn't until I actually read the caption of the image, which said, "Hope you brought an extra flashlight," and then there's little emojis of a skull and crossbone, a piece of pizza, and a panda. Then, obviously, but clearly I got carried away.
David?
I buy it because Perri, if she buys it. Usually when I go for my horror advice, I go to Perri, because I don't watch a lot of the horror movies. So it's like, you know, David, go see Green Room, go see Don't Breathe, and I go check those out. I'm always pleasantly surprised by how much I enjoy them. So if Perri gives us her back, and I give it my backing, so yeah, I'm going to buy it for sure.
Rocha?
Yeah, absolutely. I think it's a great company for them to do this with. And, you know, the people at Akira will give him an idea about development hell. The game only came out in 2014. You're not in development hell. Maybe development, you know, turnaround or whatever is a little frustrating. Maybe development purgatory, not necessarily hell. It takes a little bit of time
to get
these things.
None of those sound particularly pleasant.
Yeah, exactly. It takes some time to get one. But I think this is a great idea for a game. You know, you're stuck there from midnight to 6 a.m., right? And so you've got to get away from these animatronics. So it sounds like it'd be a fun film. And I think in Blumhouse's hands is going to be, they're the right hands to have it in, right? To play with it. And I look forward to see what they could do with it. And like you said, if Perri says go see it, I go see it. You know, Perri said Raw is all right. Raw is on my list for next week, so I'm going
to
go see that at some point. And
I
hate cannibal movies. And I hate cannibal movies, but I'm going to go.
I'm putting
Perri
my money on
that.
It. I think you're going to like it, just like you like Power Rangers. But one other point with Five Nights at Freddy's is one of the cool things that gives them a lot of opportunity with this is, as much as I know about the game, how much I've played it, it doesn't really have much of a story. So it really does give them a lot of room to play. So whoever they attach to write and direct this thing, it could be a good sandbox for them.
Cool. All right, guys, before we get into mailbag, I remind you, we're going to take your live Twitter questions at the end of the show. You can tweet us at Collider Video. Also want to make a few announcements. We had a new Jedi Council that dropped yesterday. We have actually a Rogue One commentary, which the Blu-ray comes out on Tuesday. You can buy it on digital now, but we have our commentary up now. Today, Schmodown at 2 p.m. Features a match between RB3 and Matt Nost.
Matt Nost, top 10, Boubaye.
Yeah, John Rocha's partner there, Matt Nost, and along with a five-way Inner Geekdom match that Jeremy Johns is a part of. Also, look out for a new Collider behind-the-scenes bloopers and mailbags. Also, I want to remind you guys that The Walking Dead Season 7 finale, we have our review, me, Perri, Rocha, and McCougar doing that on Sunday. But that's only after. If you are in WonderCon this weekend, there is a Schmodown panel at 1:30 p.m. to 2:30. I know Rocha over there will be there.
Woo, yeah. Baby!
I don't think you can miss it.
No, there's no chance I'm going to miss it. I'm the champ. I got to be there. Yeah. I don't know if Mark Riley's going to show up. Should he show up? I mean, the has-been, the former champion, the two-time loser. Don't show up. Do me a favor. Don't show up. Keep training. Don't waste the 2 or 3 hours you're going to be there. You got to go get back in your books. You saw what Perri, you saw what Miss Movies are doing. Go back. Go read your books. Go study these things, because I'm coming for you. See, the thing is, people think the champ sits back, just, you know, strokes his belt and gets soft and fat. That's not happening. I want to destroy everyone. All the belts, all the records. Riley, you're next. Third time I'm taking you down. I'm going to bury you once and for all. R.I.P. Mark Riley. You're going down, Riley.
So after the panel, we actually are going to have a meet and greet at 3 p.m. I think we're going to go to the Hilton, which is across the street from the convention center. There's a little lounge lobby there. We'll be there for an hour. This isn't a big formal one like we usually do for Comic-Con, but since we're going to be there, because some of us have to rush back and do that walk.
Yeah, we do. Yeah.
All right, let's move on to mailbag. Sinead, what do we got?
Joshua writes, hi, Collider crew. Greetings from Queensland, Australia. Quick question. Why don't we see more documentary directors make their way to direct a live-action film and vice versa? Is there a significant difference between the two roles? Would love to hear from you guys, and thanks so much for the daily effort you all put into doing all the shows.
David?
I think it's just different styles, you know, for directing, I think, definitely. It's a different format. I mean, I've heard from good documentary directors is when you go out to start a documentary, you let the shooting process and the people that you interview and talk to kind of make the film for you. Like it could change. I know some people start off I want to make a documentary about, I don't know, big topical issues like, you know, legalization of weed or something or abortion or something like that. And they go in and they do these. And sometimes the interviews, it changes their perspective. Whereas when you're doing a film, you have a script. You have a shooting schedule. I mean, documentary directors have shooting schedules too, but it's a much different process to make a documentary than it is to make a feature film. Not that the documentary directors can't do both, but I think it's a much different approach. So that's why when Jordan Peele, who again is already kind of a famous person, has success in that field, he's going to get picked up right away as opposed to somebody who wins the Academy Award for Best Documentary is not going to get picked up to probably direct the next Jurassic Park film. I think it's just kind of how it is. Not that they're not talented enough to do that. It's just a different
There's similarities and there's a lot of differences. I mean, both directors are storytellers, but the way they tell their story is a lot different. You know, with live action, you have things planned. You have shoot dates. With documentaries, you start and you don't know when you're ending most of the time. Sometimes people do documentaries for a year, 2 years, 3 years.
I mean, how long
whatever.
Was Schnepp? Schnepp's, I feel like, took like.
Yeah, it
three
took a long
years,
time because he was trying to get interviews. He couldn't lock He thought he was going to be able to do it in like maybe a year, year and a half. It ended up taking a lot longer because he had to lock down certain interviews and people just don't realize like it's not. With documentaries, it's not always up to you. You know, with live action, you have the cast, you pay for, you know, the actors, they read their lines, you have everything all set up. So it's a lot different. But you have like, you know, one of my favorite documentaries, King of Kong, Seth Gordon did. He made that transition to live action films. He did, Horrible Bosses. He's doing Baywatch as well. You have someone as renowned as Martin Scorsese that does documentaries all the time. He did... The Last Waltz, Shine a Light, like that Bob Dylan one. So the people can go back and forth, but there's a lot of differences. Perri?
Yeah, one of my favorite examples is probably James Marsh, just because obviously I love Man on Wire, but Project Nim, if you haven't seen that movie wrecked me. It's great. Okay. And then obviously he went on to direct Theory of Everything. But I've actually run into this problem just as a critic because my brain does not process documentaries the same way as narrative features from a reviewing perspective. It's like one of the main reasons that I ended up going back to school for film is because I had already been working as a film critic and something didn't feel right just in my own head about reviewing other people's work without knowing what the experience is like myself. So sometimes, and I've reviewed documentaries before and I review them as honestly and fairly as I possibly can, of course. But sometimes when I'm sitting there, just something about the whole process seems so foreign to me. So I can understand just from that limited perspective why it might be difficult to make the jump from one to the other. But you could pretty much say that with anything. And you could say it with live action and animation. You know, surprise, surprise, I have Del Toro on the brain. And I know Guillermo wants to get into even more animated stuff than he's already doing. It's just different mediums, different genres, different storytelling formats. The more you do, I mean, the better I think you're going to become. So hopefully we see more people making the move.
I should say real quick, I forgot about Ava DuVernay, who had 13th, was up for an Academy Award this past year.
That's such a good example.
And, you know, she also did Selma, too, so she's a fantastic director.
Well, I was going to say that, but Dave...
Oh, sorry, I'm sorry. Jesus Christ, David. I'm sorry.
I get it, you got to cater. I get
it. Yeah, I pick over at your notes sometimes.
You do, I know you do. No, for me, it's. I think people who become documentary filmmakers are driven by a different muse. They're different. They're driven by something else. They want to highlight these issues. They want to explore these issues. They want to show the general public a more in-depth exploration of these issues. So it doesn't necessarily, they don't necessarily have that desire to go to narrative filmmaking. It isn't always that way. Yeah. Some do, right? You mentioned Scorsese. Spike Lee does the same thing, back and forth. Mm-hmm. You know, he does that. I think Steve James did that. Steve James did Hoop Dreams, right? And he ended up directing Prefontaine. So, you know, there are some that do make the jump. The woman who did Winter's Bone, Deborah Granik, she had done a bunch of documentaries and then moved into more narrative filmmaking. So it just all depends on what you're driven by and what you want to accomplish. Even Sarah Polley, who's an actress, started doing documentaries and then moved into narrative. So it's all a matter of what you're driven by, right? I think a lot of these documentary filmmakers, they like staying where they're at. Michael Moore is never going to direct a narrative film. For him, documentaries are more about what he wants to do, what he wants to expose, because in a way, they're extended reports, right? Mm. And so they're driven by a journalistic desire to create these documentaries that showcase these issues.
Well, Michael Moore did direct one.
Did he? Oh, I'm sorry. What did he do?
I think it was like, was it Canadian Bacon or something?
Oh, was that him?
It was the one where they invade.
Yes,
they
Canadian Bacon.
Invade Canada.
Oh, with John Candy. Isn't that the one, John Candy?
I forgot exactly. He made one narrative attempt.
Yeah, okay. Well, he should not.
Yeah. All right, guys, we're running low on time, so we'll take three live Twitter questions. Wendy, what do we got?
First one comes from Ashwin Jacob, who writes, thoughts on the 1 week delay of Dark Tower release and reports that the visual effects from the footage of CinemaCon was not good.
I mean, they've been delaying this movie for a while. What's 1 week? You know what I mean? I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, what's 1 week? The bigger point that has me more nervous at this time is just that I've heard from friends who saw that footage that they didn't love it. And, you know, this is something that I'm not particularly familiar with this source material, and it's something that I want to be inspired to actually read, so I'm a little disappointed to hear that.
Yeah, it's a bit of a misleading headline, right? It's only 1 week. It's not delayed to another, like, summer to winter or something like that.
Look at what's coming out that week, too. Maybe there's something else that's really big that they want to...
Absolutely,
move aside
from. I think that's true. That's very true. And that's unfortunate. That's unfortunate.
Also, too, I hope it's good because I know McConaughey had an interview recently where he talked about the reason why he turned down Guardians of the Galaxy 2 because he wanted a new challenge. He wanted to do something risky. Guardians of the Galaxy 2, for lack of a better word, it's safe. You know, it's probably a guaranteed financial success, and he wanted to take something risky. So I hope that it's good. Yeah. I hope the risk was worth it.
Yeah. All right. What's next?
Matthew Spencer writes, should anime material stay in that form for a movie adaptation or do live action? It feels like it's more beautiful in its original format.
I mean, I wouldn't say you can or cannot translate something. We do that all the time with other materials and mediums. We have video games, books, comic books, we plays, anything. It's more about the adaptation. Some things lend themselves to a great adaptation, some don't. It all depends on what it is. I don't think anything in anime should never be touched or something. You know what I mean? I think as a medium, some things will translate over.
Yeah, that's a great point you make, Dennis, because at Disney, we see that happening now with live action, from anime to live action. If you got to do it right. You got to respect the source material. That's really important. I talked about this yesterday on Twitter and Instagram. I rewatched Watchmen, the director's cut, the 3-hour. I actually like it now, and I didn't think I would. I didn't like it the first time around. I didn't think I'd like it revisiting it. But he brings the right attention to detail to that particular project to that. So you can make this transfer. You just have to have people in the right position who understand the material to bring it to life correctly. So it you cannot have strict things of you cannot adapt this at all, you know?
Perri?
I don't think there's anything that's out of the realm of possibility in this industry, whether it's adapting something to a new medium, whether it's trying to get a particular franchise off the ground. Anything is possible as long as you have the right team behind it. Mm. I just like the idea of, because I don't know much about anime. I haven't had much experience with that in my life. And I say this all the time with things that are being adapted to film. If I'm not familiar with it, that's a cool thing because I want to see it and then be inspired to explore it. It's the same thing I just said with The Dark Tower. I've never been motivated to read that ginormous book. Mm. But if I love that movie enough, I'm going to want to go read it. So the more different things that I'm not already exposed to that you can bring to me in formats that just naturally appeal to me, that's great.
David?
I think, like I said before with Akira, you know, it's just kind of, I know that's horrible Japanese, just breaking those cultural boundaries. Like when I watch, I watch One Punch Man and I like Attack on Titan, but sometimes I'm confused. Like it's a different way of watching television. You're watching, you know, Legend of Korra or Avatar The Last Airbender. It's done in a more Western American way. But when you hear you know, everybody's yelling all the time. You know, the eyes are always big and they're shaking and they're always freaking out. I'm like, why are they doing that? It's just a different way of presenting a entertainment. It's just different. I think you have to find that balance to translate it so people from America and from, you know, out east can kind of, you know, come together and enjoy it together. Sorry, I don't mean to be insensitive. I'm just trying to figure out. It's different. It's good, though.
You don't mind when Elijah Wood is doing it, do you? You got big eyes. He's shaking all the time. Is there no difference there?
You put it. Bring up a good point, because The Last Airbender is a movie that I saw first. Terrible, terrible.
Horrible,
movie.
One of the worst
movies I've ever seen.
Horrible. Yes.
But I went to go watch the original source material, and I love...
So good.
Avatar, The Last Airbender, the animated stuff. So, you know, even a horrible movie can change your mind, and you can go back and check the source material. Mm-hmm. All right, last one.
Last one comes from Harry J.A. Killick, who writes... What happens if Han Solo movie bombs?
No.
Valid question.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know if it could bomb. Maybe it won't do as well as they're expecting it to, and then maybe they will reassess how they do their spinoff movies, but there's no way that it's going to bomb.
Oh, I think that is so far out of the realm of possibility. That would have been a more serious question, which is something that we did raise when we were talking about Rogue One, the very first standalone movie, and one that rested on characters that people weren't super familiar with, with a Han Solo movie starring, I mean, that's just got like an epic roster of cast members. It's got Lord and Miller at the helm. I don't think that movie has anything to worry about.
You know, it's going to happen. Pixar had a bad movie. I mean, just, you know, no matter what your run is, you're going to have one. If this happens, it'll be a blight on the resume for Lord and Miller. It'll be, and I think Dennis is right. You reassess how you approach these films. Maybe he wasn't the right choice for Solo. It's Han Solo. And there's been backlash to this idea of making a Han Solo film, because people like the mystery of not knowing this stuff about Han in his past. So there could be people who rebel against it. And it may be a number of factors that the reason that the film doesn't do well. It could be a number of things.
I think it'll do well. I mean, the same backlash that, you know, a lot of the James Bond hardcore fans had with, you know, Skyfall and Spectre. Oh, yeah. It's like, we're learning too much about Bond. I don't want to know about his parents and where he grew up. I don't want to see his childhood home, but those are still making bank. So I think, you know, a new generation is watching this. I think they're going to enjoy it. I think it's going to do well.
All right, guys. I want to thank everyone for joining us on today's Collider Movie Talk. I want to thank the people joining us on the panel. Perri, where can people find you?
I am on Twitter and Instagram at PNemiroff. And then, of course, Collider Behind the Scenes Day is tomorrow. Tomorrow is also April Fool's Day, so you pretty much have some guaranteed nonsense in this weekend's episode. Also, just a huge thank you to anyone who sent me pictures or tweets or whatever about seeing Child Eater, the movie I produced. It came out on Tuesday. I mean, it freaking warms my heart to no end. If you haven't seen it and you want to, if you just go to childeater.com, thank God we own that URL, there's all this information about where you could find the movie. So enjoy and thank you guys for the support. Yeah.
That's awesome. Yeah. Congratulations. I had no idea.
You drive me crazy.
I'll bring you a copy.
Oh, wow. I want to see that.
Care about your friends, man.
I try.
Hey, you don't pick on D-Griff.
I'm just giving him shit.
Rocha.
Yeah, you guys can always find me at The Rocha Says on Twitter and Instagram. Like Dennis mentioned, on Sunday, we are doing the finale for Collider Walking Dead. I cannot wait to see what happens. Are we getting the knockdown drag out, or are they going to screw this? We will find out on Sunday. And of course, we just dropped a new episode of The Cinephiles that is on iTunes and on Stitcher. Please listen to it. We welcome the great Yuri Lowenthal, the voice of Ben 10 and numerous characters in animated series. And we talk Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory, which I had never watched before we recorded the podcast. So I watched it before we recorded the podcast. So much fun. And that's all I've got going on.
David.
You can find me at GriffinDE on Twitter and Instagram. Also, I'll be at WonderCon tomorrow walking the floors, just chilling. So if you want to come up and say hi, if you see my bald head walking around there, make sure you come up and say hi. Also, too, you know, we have, of course, TV Talk every Monday. A lot to talk about. We're doing 13 Reasons Why or something. That's a new Netflix series that's out right now. It's very good. I watched the first episode this morning. Definitely check that out. And, yeah, I'll see you there.
Wendy.
I'll also be at WonderCon tomorrow, so if you see me, come and say hi. You can find me on YouTube at the Movie Couple channel and on Twitter, Instagram, Snapchat at Wendy Lee Zaney.
Where can people find you, Sinead?
Well, I will also be at WonderCon tomorrow. And possibly on Sunday too. But I'm online at Sinead DeVries and at thatsosinead.com.
You guys can find me on Twitter at ThinkHero, Instagram, Dennis.tzng. Yeah, I'll be on the Walking Dead Season 7 finale review with Perri, Rocha, and Makuga. Also, I'll be at the Schmodown panel at WonderCon. We'll have a little short meet and greet after that. I want to thank Adam and Cody in the back over there. And we will see you guys next week.
Hey, guys, if you... this video, click the up button. Also, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. It'll help you stay up to date with everything we've got going on here at Collider.